Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program today, we have Ann Hayes, who is with Smart Girl Politics and social media person at PLF. Welcome to the show, Ann. And also David Peters from Folsom. And you're in the computer IT business somehow or another, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Well, thanks for being here.
Mostly ERP software.
ERP software, okay. Yeah. Whatever that is.
Enterprise Resource Planning.
There you go, okay.
Whatever that is.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, it makes computers go... Do things, right?
Mm.
So, yeah, okay, I don't know.
Gives us something to do.
Okay, yeah. This is the show that we're doing after the Republican landslide. The Republicans on Tuesday took the House and made serious inroads in the Senate, took a lot of governorships, a lot of state legislatures, and a lot of the energy came from the Tea Party movement. Would you agree with that?
I think a lot of the energy did. But I think there was more than that at stake. I think the Tea Party is more or less symptomatic of...
Emblematic, maybe, of
a sort of a general discontent with government. I think Angelo Codavia really nailed it in his article. I don't know if you saw that. American Spectator printed an excerpt called The Ruling Class. And it was, to my mind at least, a very insightful analysis of, you know, people were disillusioned with Washington everywhere. I mean, I think many Democrats were who probably couldn't disagree more with the Tea Party, but they were very upset about, you know, sort of how Washington has been running things lately.
What's interesting to me is we've got Rand Paul, we've got a number of other people who were elected on more or less Tea Party, more or less small government, more or less we're going to Washington to take our government back kind of themes. They're going to go there, and they're going to meet up with the old bulls like Trent Lott, if he's still around, and Lindsey Graham, and people that are, John McCain, people that are the Republican establishment that do not share those values for the most part. They like things the way they are. How is that culture clash going to work? What's going to happen once... January rolls around and the Republicans actually have control of the House of Representatives?
Well, I think that's a good question, but I think part of that will have to do with how energized the Tea Party and others who are upset and who were a great impetus behind what happened in this election, how active they continue to be. I mean, I think...
What, do they keep the pressure on?
Keep the pressure on, because I think the writing is on the wall from this election that when that pressure is on, things change. And if they keep the pressure on, they're going to be watching 2012, believe me. When you have 25 Democrats in the Senate of the 33 who are going up for re-election in 2012, I think they're going to be a little more wary of what's going on, because there is so much more attention, which I think is actually the healthiest thing about the Tea Party movement. The healthiest thing was taking the focus off of the White House. I mean, people, you know, this whole blame Bush nonsense. The idea that the White House runs the country or runs the economy, when the game's been in Congress forever. I mean, they're the ones where the bills originate. Sure, the president sets the agenda, but the budget is made in Congress. And for the first time, Americans are, you know, reading the Constitution and paying attention to what's going on in the Senate and House of Representatives. So I think what happens will depend, and as you say, the culture clash will depend on that. But then on the other side of it, probably from my background at Pacific Legal Foundation, is the notion that what happens in our political offices is probably not where our freedoms are really being taken. It's being taken by the bureaucracies. And unless they address that issue, I mean, it's not the budget. I mean, as bad as the budget is and as bad as the deficit is and the debt, the freedom issue is really going on at the bureaucratic level of what they're doing, both local and federal. And my big question is, fine, attack the spending, but what are you going to do about reining in the power of EPA, reining in the power of Fish and Wildlife Service, reining in the power? That's where we're losing our freedoms, I think. And those bureaucracies go on no matter who's in the Senate and House of Representatives and the White House. They live forever. The people who administrate those have careers there. They don't get voted out every 2 years and 4 years and 6 years. So, whether this signals a huge change in how our government does business, I don't want to be pessimistic, but unless the new blood that goes in understands that that's where our freedoms are really being taken from us, unless they
John Boehner in his press conference right after the election was called for the Republicans in the House, said the right things and got emotional and looked very very persuasive as being as having bought into the the whole freedom movement, the whole small government is better and so forth. Eric Cantor, the presumptive GOP majority leader, has unveiled a 22-point program. But as I look at it, it's very long on procedural changes like eliminating earmarks and voting procedures and so forth, and it's short of any kind of substantive spending cuts, things like things that have to be attacked if you're going to get the budget in balance, namely Social Security, Medicare, and the military. Is the Republican Party going to try to paper over the differences, or are they going to at some point actually start cutting into the meat? And by the meat, I mean not only the big spending programs, but also the administrative agencies that in many cases could be like the Department of Education, Department of Energy, should be eliminated entirely.
Absolutely. I don't know if they're going to have a political will. That might be one of the big advantages of a term limit for our federal officials, and that is this willingness to make the tough decisions. Because right now they're so beholden to getting reelected that they'll promise everything and unfortunately print money to deliver everything, and so you end up with not having the political will to make the tough choices that you need to make to address these very serious problems. And what bothers me is none of them are willing to make that case. I was kind of impressed with Chris Christie. He's very plain spoken. I'm not going to go and stump for him, but when I've seen him speak, he's saying, look, we just don't have the money. We're going to have to do something. He's willing to lay out the problem and say we've got to do something.
Governor of New Jersey.
He's willing to stand up to the teachers' union members and say, hey,
you guys just
can't do this. Yeah. We don't have the money. Unlike the federal government, we can't print it. Are these newly elected people going to have guts once they get in to make those tough choices and to force the rest and bring attention to it? They have a great ability, Rand Paul and so on. They have a great ability now because of the national attention. Did anyone ever know who was running for Kentucky Senate before? Now everybody
did anybody care?
Well, the guy that Rand Paul replaced was a Republican football player whose name I can't remember.
Can't even remember, right? So he's a freshman senator, and everybody knows him. Is he going to use that attention?
I think in the case of Rand Paul, he will. In his acceptance speech, he said, "What did he say?" He said, "I'm going to join the Senate, the world's greatest deliberative body." And he said, and I quote, "Deliberate on this. We've come to take our government back." Now, that's a call to action. That's
such a crock. we always had our government. We could always vote for it. We got the government we voted for.
Unfortunately,
I hate to say it, but Rand Paul is a nice Tea Party. He's a nice guy, but he's part of the problem.
I think it's too soon. I think it's way too soon to say that.
Because the Tea Party. I've been to several of the Tea Party demonstrations, and all they care about is they cut back on our Medicare payments, and
I don't believe that.
Oh, excuse me. You ought to hear them.
I've been to Tea Parties as well.
There are people at the Tea Parties
who have that opinion.
I'm sure they
but that's
do.
Certainly
He's
not.
With all the speakers But the thing is, the Tea Party says we want government.
I've heard Ann talk at a Tea Party movement, and she didn't say that.
Well, you would have been the one in 100 who didn't. they talk about limited government, cutting back on government. And I look at a couple of them and I said, you realize, of course, that means no Social Security, no Medicare. And, no, we have to have that. We can't cut. Then what are you going to cut?
Right. It's a bunch of old
white people who want to make sure that their benefits aren't cut.
You're sounding like the liberals there.
No, I'm sounding like somebody who should take Newt Gingrich and use him for road fill. Okay, his contract with America lasted exactly until they got into power, and they proceeded to become Democrat light.
Well, wait a minute.
There were budget surpluses. I will disagree with you.
But that's a point.
I will disagree
and
with
they
you
couldn't
on
figure
that.
Out how to spend it
the Contract of America, they did everything that they promised to do in the Contract of America,
which
was to introduce the legislation to do a bunch of different things. Mm-hmm. They didn't all pass, but they did everything that they promised to do in the contract.
They couldn't even pass
once
it
that,
in the
once,
House.
Once they did all of those things, then they backtracked. Yeah. I'll grant you, but
they certainly backtracked in the Bush administration. If the contract with America was to make a sea change in American politics, that lasted long enough to get them elected.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're talking.
And then they
tacked
with the wind.
Yeah, we're talking about politics here.
Yeah, no, you're right. There's been a huge shift.
Am I cynical?
Yes, you are. Mm. I still believe that.
They mean that, well? Yeah.
No. That there are ways to solve problems. I'm not entirely pessimistic. Do I believe necessarily? I think it remains to be seen. Mm. The only point I was making with Rand Paul is you know, he does have national attention.
Yeah.
And the people, if they're not worried about re-election, and they're willing to educate the public on those issues, we can make a difference.
Sure.
But you also pointed to the one big problem facing everybody is the economy and jobs and a boom, you know.
If we can cut taxes.
People have
and
said.
You said earlier when we were talking off camera that we have to have a stable environment for business to invest and to plan for tomorrow.
Right.
Then if we can at least introduce gridlock for the next 2 years, the damage can't get any worse and you can at least plan on that.
Right.
Well, yeah, gridlock is always a good thing.
It's a good thing
when you can't go make changes in the right direction.
So you simply stop it from getting any worse.
Right.
And this is the biggest worry that a lot of businesses have is what else, what other brick is going to fall?
Well, exactly. And as I say, you know, we were talking about GM off camera that, you know, part of the problem was there that they changed the rules. I mean, you couldn't agree, and that's a big problem.
Sure.
When the rights that you think you have, the government completely obliterates them.
Yes.
That's actually worse than, you know, knowing what bad news is coming up, because if what you think is a sure thing is suddenly not because the government changes the rules on you.
But it still goes back to the issue you were talking about. You know, the various bureaucracies reclaiming the Congress needs to reassert itself and say, this is what we expect these bureaucracies to do.
And they have the power to do that.
We're not giving them free reign anymore.
Right.
They can't write their own rules.
Yeah.
Well,
which
see,
they're doing.
But
and Congress can do that.
Congress
well, they can.
Yeah,
they can amend it. They do write a sloppy law, and the biggest thing that most people don't, I mean, I used to give speeches on this, is they don't realize that most actual law is not coming out of Congress. Mm-hmm. It's coming out of regulatory agencies.
Yeah, so it's not
because
law.
They have,
it's regulatory determination.
Well, but see, the
but
courts have upheld.
It has the power of law.
Regulations
well, of
have the force
does,
of law.
It,
they have rulemaking power.
This is what I love, is to jump down Prop 19. And you have the affirmative action attorney general who can't, as far as I'm concerned, would never have gotten his job were it not for the fact that he is not white. Holder is not competent to be
attorney general.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I thought we were going to Prop 19 California, Jerry Brown.
But,
sorry.
No, but he came in and said, I will prosecute anybody who, if they try and make it, if it's recreational uses of a drug, because it's contrary to federal law.
Yes.
Well, the incompetent klutz 6 months before had said, we won't prosecute anybody who wants it for medicinal purposes. That's still a violation of federal law.
Exactly.
And then he says, we will then prosecute anybody who tries to collect the tax. There's already a federal tax. Mm-hmm. The man is ignorant and a posturing fool. Okay?
Well, that's
so
not
that,
a pain
but,
point
but,
worth debating.
No, but he said that marijuana is against, it's a clash between the state saying this and federal law, and it's a bureaucratic determination that is totally arbitrary because that bureaucracy has also never allowed any testing to determine whether it should be a Schedule I drug. It was Panic City. When it spread from the black ghettos in the inner cities into white usage, all of a sudden marijuana became, oh my God, we can't have that. So it's very much, when it was just confined to certain subgroups, it was tolerated.
That's the whole conundrum of the drug
war. But that becomes DEA.
One of the issues on the election was that the mainstream media spin on the election was that the real winners and the real losers, according to the media, the elections were funded by the Koch brothers and by the corporate powers, under you know, underwritten by the fact that United, whatever, the Supreme Court case that allowed free speech to
prevail.
Citizens United.
Citizens United.
Yeah, the media spin was that the Republicans had all of this huge corporate money coming in. Well, and therefore, were in the process of buying the election. And the Koch brothers became the symbol of that.
Sure.
From the other point of view, from the other side, we look at people like the unions, SEIU, and to put a face on it, George Soros. As the people who were funding, in their case, the Democrats. And so in a sense, we're looking at big money Democrats fighting big money Republicans for control of the process. And who are the winners? Who are the losers? It looks to me like the Koch brothers actually won and George Soros lost. Case in point, the Secretary of State project. MoveOn.org came up with the Secretary of State project. I think it was MoveOn. Anyway, somebody came up with that, which was the idea, and it goes back to the Florida election that was a squeaker for George W., where Catherine Harris, the Secretary of State of Florida, moved, you know, was instrumental in moving the election in George Bush's direction. So the Democrats said, okay, we need to take over all of the Secretary of State offices so that we can you know, we have control over these dirty tricks.
Well,
and so George Soros funded the Secretary of State project. Of the Secretary of State elections in the last election on November 3rd, 17 of 26 went to the GOP. Did George Soros, was that a repudiation of George Soros?
Oh, gosh, no. I think it simply points out that nobody even knows what the Secretary of State does in their state, and nobody even knows who they are.
Well, when you go back and look, my brother lives in Florida, and I teased him for months after the debacle in 2000. I said, my God, Panama has better election laws than Florida.
I was waiting for
Third world countries have better election laws than Florida. You have three sets of qualifying standards, and each one of them pointed to a different one. Yeah. So it wasn't the fact that it was Secretary of State. That was a stalking horse.
It was the hanging Chad.
George Soros also backed an initiative which Initiative 27, I believe it was, which would have done away with the Redistricting Commission entirely. And that failed. The redistricting commission
now
survived, which means that redistricting is done by a commission, an independent commission, as opposed to by the legislature. The legislature put in Proposition 20, which would, the voters added Proposition 20, which added congressional districts to the commissioning the redistricting commission. That passed. So we have, I think, a great opportunity in California for an awful lot less gerrymandering than we've had in the past.
It'll also be a public issue now.
It'll depend on whether or not the commission is better at redistricting, less partisan
at
redistricting.
It'll be far more transparent
than the legislature was. The legislature was, you know, they put together their maps, and the Republicans decided we want X number of safe districts. Democrats get X number of safe districts, and very few of the districts are swing districts, if any.
That's what was interesting was the last election, 2008, one district was contested.
95%, I believe, of congressional incumbents win re-election
Of the Assembly and Senate, one was contested. This time he got 67% of the vote.
Wow. Was there a little bit of redistricting or gerrymandering going on? No, he just got lucky.
McClintock.
McClintock.
He barely squeaked in the last time.
He
moved up here. And so he wasn't well known. This time he got 67%.
Well, he's been very outspoken.
He fits the district.
I mean, that was the only contested election. All the rest of them were guaranteed.
Oh, that's interesting.
By gerrymandering. That's why Doolittle opposed the previous redistricting plan, because he said, I won't be able to get reelected if I have an open district.
I think actually the good thing about those two propositions related to gerrymandering, and there is a debate about whether it's gerrymandering or gerrymandering, the man it's actually named for was Gary. So anyway.
Gary San Francisco, and his was pronounced Jerry anyway.
But the point is, actually what I like again is it's bringing attention to the problem of gerrymandering, whether that will carry beyond, you know, this one little election. I don't know. I mean, well, it's a huge. It decides
but
so
it's
much.
It's gone back to another issue of a totally dysfunctional legislature in California, that is so partisan that it can't be trusted. Why do you think we have so many ballot initiatives?
I know we do
decide
have.
Issues that they either they're terrified of going after.
Sure, the hard ones.
Or they simply don't want to be bothered because. It could be held. They could foot could be held to the fire in the next election.
Sure.
One
so
of the
they
other
abdicate all the responsibilities.
So. One of the other issues that the newly elected Congress is going to face is the issue of how to spend their time. They can spend their time doing constructive things like repeal bad laws like Obamacare and get rid of departments like the Department of Education or the Department of Energy and so forth. They could do things like that, and really in the process, even if they're not successful, educate the public. Or they can do what I think perhaps you were referring to when you talked about the Gingrich class of 94, which was scandalmonger Bill Clinton, dredging up all kinds of Monica Lewinsky kind of things.
Oh, yeah.
We are looking at a possibility for, or certainly a temptation for Republicans to do the Lewinsky kind of investigations. I'm not saying there's a Lewinsky involved here, but I'm just saying looking for scandal and using the subpoena power to unmask a scandal, whether it exists or not, and just waste a whole lot of time and press and political capital trying to make the Democrats look bad, making the trial of Rangel and Waters show trials. There's a lot of things that the Republicans can do, which don't have anything to do with policy, might get them some good press,
I think it's bad press. I think it's a waste of time. Obviously, that's not what the voters care about. I mean, they did in the sense that they don't want corruption. But why waste your time on that? That's nothing. That doesn't.
Well, Darrell Issa has got the gavel now of the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee, and he is talking about doing these things.
Well, they were talking today also about telling the White House not to destroy any records, they're going to use their subpoena power. But, I would really rather not see them spend. There are so many problems.
Well, the problem is that the House can only make mischief.
Well,
because until the next budget comes up.
Well, no, they can write budgets.
But
that's except for not funding anything in the next fiscal year, which won't take place until next October 1st.
But that's fine.
Time to make mischief. But that's the whole idea of having two opposing parties.
Mm-hmm.
One rides herd on the other.
Yeah.
So Her Majesty's or His Majesty's loyal opposition does exactly that with a shadow government. Because you sit there and you say...
Well, you're talking about the minority role now, and the Republicans are actually in the majority in the House.
But they're not in power. True. Therefore,
they have the power of the purse.
Yes.
Don't underestimate the power that they do have.
True, but that's going to take 11 months to take effect.
That's fine.
So
everything moves
forward.
Well,
except
very
simple. That
if you're
there's
not
going to
fund anything, you're going to have plenty of time to make mischief.
Well, they can stop... Any more TARP spending and any more bailout money from being spent.
They can't stop it from being spent if it's already been authorized.
There are several billion that's still on the table. I mean, and however much you say that's not enough, it's still very symbolic and meaningful in the sense of where their political will is.
They could initiate legislation to rein in the Federal Reserve. They could do pass an audit of the Fed bill in the House.
That's making mischief. It won't go anywhere.
Well, fine, but it's making mischief that would be educational to the public at large.
We've already acknowledged that with the Senate in the hands of the Republicans and the House or in the hands of the Democrats and the House in the hands of the Republicans, White House. Democrat, that our best scenario is one of gridlock. So how do you use that gridlock?
And mischief.
Well, except
well,
not just
well,
mischief, because
mischief.
That would be a waste of their political capital.
True, but the thing is, you're on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
You can't change anything, except you can stop it from going forward, but you can't change what's already in there. So therefore, make use of that fact to constantly point up what was done previously and hound them about it and plan for the next election. Because like you said, 25 to 33 senators coming up in 2012 are Democrat.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to be watching their backsides.
Right. But I think the people aren't interested in scandal. I agree with it, with the mischief thing, but not at the level of pointing out the Rangel issues.
No.
They do have to make serious mischief in the sense of pay attention to what people really care about. point out what's happening with the budget.
Sure.
You know, put the blame where it belongs.
Yes, but that's
very
that,
squarely,
but
and they
the
have
of,
to
but
be.
But the point of view of a
that.
Democrat.
Put the fact that we're spending 40% more than we're taking in taxes, mm-hmm. In dollar terms. How much is that on a per capita basis? I mean, that's the kind of thing that they should be doing.
$1.5 trillion deficits in a row. Yeah. I mean, what case has to be made?
Yeah. Well, you put it on a personal level.
Right.
This is how much they're spending on your behalf
exactly.
that you're going to have to pay later.
And there was an article in today's paper that Obama is now, or Newsmax.com, that Obama is considering extending the Bush tax cuts for
right.
everybody.
For everybody.
Of course, God only knows what he's going to want in return.
Yeah.
But he's going to say, well, I'll sign this if you give me that. So it's going to,
well,
but anyway, earmarks.
There's one other topic.
You may not have much of a choice. I mean, some of the Senate Democrats have already conceded that.
You know what
that,
they used to call earmarks back when I was?
Pork?
No. Log rolling.
Log rolling,
same
that's
thing.
Right.
Yes, and it was a respectable thing in those
sure.
days.
I want to get you guys' thoughts on one other issue, which was decided in the last election. Prop 19 went up in smoke. Should it have, or should it, or did the voters do the right thing?
I think the voters did the right thing.
Why?
Because, look, I'm not necessarily one to outlaw every vice, but I, you know, look, I'm a person who believes in being healthy, and also that the purpose of recreational drugs is just to encourage just a bunch of people to waste their lives and their, I don't believe we should legislate every moral issue, but I don't know. I think it just would have been one more nail in the coffin of California.
I voted for it. I voted for it with misgivings. My misgivings were, I mean, I don't think that it's the government's business how you recreate, as long as you're not bothering anybody else. But I had misgivings but because of the fact that it made it very difficult for employers to discipline employees were high on the job or something like that.
It was specific in the law that that would not have an effect. The whole point was that you couldn't now get arrested for using it because, I mean, there are a lot of issues to be worked out. But I love that everybody who opposed, oh, but it'll make it easier for the kids to get it. How do you think we find it now?
We ask the kids.
Yes.
Yeah,
anyway, the little darlings are using less of it every year.
Well, but when their parents are using it at home.
But
it's legal now,
which
look,
smoking. Well, it doesn't make any difference what they're smoking. Haven't you had that little cartoon, Calvin, with his father's a postman, and every time his father lights up a cigarette, the kid grabs it, throws it in the toilet, because his kid loves his father and doesn't want him to die of lung cancer.
Look, so, but, you know, look,
I mean,
but look at the society we live
smoking.
In right now, where you know there is no sense of personal responsibility. That the law for many people is simply the arbiter of what's good and what's bad, which I don't. We have almost no social pressure left in terms of behavior.
And I think
so when you legalize it, I think you're putting the sanction of the state on the behavior itself, you're allowing people to abdicate their judgment. Now, are people stupid in doing that? Yes, they are.
I think it's the opposite. I think what you're doing is you're saying that the government has the power to make judgments, so we don't have to. That's the time we have. We'll see you again next week, same time. Yeah, last word. Same time, same place. Libertarian Counterpoint. Thanks for being with us.